The video.
Okay, so we're pretty much ready to go. So we're here at Factory Farm. We've got about a dozen people at our open source mapping and site design workshop. We have a special guest, Darren Doherty, tonight, talking about basic principles of site and farm design. So we'll let Darren take off from here. Darren.
Okay, thanks, Marcin, and welcome everyone. I won't put the video on because it's not pretty. But what I do have some stuff to show you, so I might get stuck straight into that. I've been given the brief to discuss the basics of land planning and landscape architecture, the yeoman scale of permanence, water and erosion calculations, keyline design and earthworks, planting design and layers of a baseline composite map. So I think I'll be able to cover all of those things in the session that we've got. How much time do we have, Marcy?
1.5 hours.
Oh, yeah, I think we should do that. Okay, so now, if anybody's got any questions or anything while we're going along, that's absolutely fine. But if you, I suppose they'll go through you, Marcy. Is that how it'll best work?
Yeah, everyone is here, so they can probably speak up if. I guess we should ask questions if we have some pressing questions to ask. Yeah. Everyone here is in a
state. Yeah, or maybe the questions will go through you, so if they're asked, you'll repeat them, and so the recording's efficient.
Okay.
Sufficient, and I'll then reply as I can.
Great, that would work.
Okay, cool. Right, so I think what I'll do is I'll start with this here. Just so that we've got a bit of a sense of the some of the parameters by which we work, the Regrarians platform, which some of you will already be familiar with, and you'll know that it's founded. Well, if you do know about the Regrarians platform, you will know that it's founded upon the Yeoman's Keyline scale of permanence of all things agricultural, which is its full title. And that was first released as a concept in 1958 in The Challenge of Landscape, P.A. Yeoman's second book. For those of you who don't know P.A. Yeoman's, whose photo is down there in the bottom left, that's from about 1981, just a couple of years before he died. He was a mining engineer who in the 1940s decided to, with his wealth that he built as a young man, to buy decrepit properties and then renovate them. And through that process, he came up with the whole Keyline program, which many people across the world still use to this day, and wrote 4 books on the topic and a number of articles and so on. He was also a machine engineer. He and his middle son, Alan Yeomans, who's still alive and runs the Yeomans Plough Company. They work together with PA's nephew, John Ryan, to develop the first Yeomans Plough, or as it was known, the Bunyip Slipper Imp with Shake Air Repair, the Soil Maker Supreme in 1990, which won the Prince Philip Industrial Design Award for best design in 1974. Prince Philip is Queen Elizabeth's husband. So, if you look at the scale of permanence, the first part is from Yeoman's perspective, this was all about the physical nature of the property and physical priorities that one would apply to landscape design. And this for him extended right through into his last book, the City Forum in 1971. So you start with climate, that's what you have to deal with. It determines much of how the land is shaped and formed. So some of you will be in the northern parts of the North American continent. Well, the climate is what shaped the land there because it's what created the glaciers. So the glaciation is, and all the remnants of the glaciation was a interaction between the geology and the climate. So the land shape is what's left behind from that interaction, and also the parent material. So that's the land shape is the interaction between the geomorphological interaction between the climate and the geology or parent material. Those two things are obviously things that we find very difficult to change. The land show can only be changed by using earth-moving equipment, whether it be a shovel to a 50-ton excavator. Water supply is determined by the relationship between climate and geography or land shape, and it is probably the first thing that we can really make some differences to in terms of human impact. And so that's dealt with by, again, earthworks and drilling holes in the ground like people in America tend to do, overbuilding ponds and so on. Farm roads then come after that, and trees, permanent buildings, subdivision fences and soils. Why those are all in the order that they're in is because if well developed, a water supply will last longer than a farm road, but also a water supply has a greater level of importance. Water supply, once you get all of the water supply lines in, whether it's the ponds or the diversion channels or swales, if people are building swales or any of those different kinds of structures, they create the sort of layout to the property within a keyline plan. And then everything else follows those particular shapes and lines, which themselves follow the land shape or the topography. The next thing is trees. Well, trees don't last as long as farm roads do, typically. Earthworks are very, if they're done properly, last for a tremendous amount of time. I was lucky enough to go to Rome years ago, and I was able to see the Circus Maximus, which, if I just switch for a moment, I'll show you. It's over here. Where are you? Circus Maximus. I don't know how quickly things are moving on your screen, but sometimes that is... this is the Circus Maximus.
Yep.
Some of you might have seen a movie called Ben-Hur years ago. I can't remember, with Charlton Heston. And it was staged in this 2 kilometre long racetrack that was built over 2,000 years ago. And when you look at the earthworks, they're absolutely as good as the day they were first done. Topsoil batters and all. So, you know, when we look at that, you can see that the earthworks that you do will have a long time in the ground, or on the ground. Trees typically last longer than a lot of buildings do, particularly the way people build buildings these days, out of the ship materials, etc. And then fences last less time than trees or buildings, and then soils can be destroyed and created extremely quickly. So that's the nature of the pattern of permanence here. So has anybody got any queries on that at all?
So soils are the quickest to change. For example, if we want to grow peaches here, they require sandy soil, and we have very clay soil. Are you saying we can change it to sandy soil?
Yes, you can turn clay into sand if you treat it badly enough, but that's not something we would advise as a way of being able to grow peaches. What you would do to your soil so that you were capable of growing peaches is you would raise your soil onto a mound, so because peaches will grow on clay soils where there's adequate drainage. And so if you've got a heavy clay soil, the most typical remedy to poor drainage is mounding of various sizes. So that would be the normal practice. Plus, of course, if one was to try and improve the drainage even further, well then the internal drainage characteristics of soils are best achieved by establishing a very decent, great soil structure, and that's managed by amending the soil chemically using minerals or compounds such as gypsum, which works to flocculate the clay particles so that you attain a better chemical structure, but then also to improve the amount of biology and residue of biology, and that's done by adding both organisms, microorganisms, and by adding things like compost, which will aid to increase the soil carbon content. So if you put those, you put a structure together, deal with the soil structure by mounding, but then also deal with it internally, then you should be able to grow peaches just as I do on my heavy clay soils at home.
Okay.
So any other, anybody else got any other questions on the Keyline scale of permanence?
I think we're
very good. Okay, so what we've done
improving the soil texture, for instance, is very key topics on between silt to sandy soil.
So you're asking for a key reference
on something we could follow, or we could, because here it's one of the major issue, right, with the heavy soil.
So we're asking here for a key reference on the topic of amending soil structure, like, for example, from clay to more drainage. Is there some good seminal work on that, or anything you can refer us to, or
your work? There's a few pieces. Yeoman's work is one. B.A. Yeoman's, he sort of started his Keyline pathway in the era of the soil conservation era, the 1940s and 50s. And soil conservation was a practice that was largely about soil conservation as opposed to soil creation and changing soil. So, in soil conservation, which follows through to today in the US, with the way the Natural Resource Conservation Service works, which is the new name for the old Soil Conservation Service. The discussion isn't there about changing soils, about just working with what you've got. So I'd look at Yeoman's reference. Another reference which I found years ago, which I really enjoyed, I'll just pull it out, was written in 1963. It's called Vegetation and Soils, a World Picture. And what it makes a really clear case for, it's written by S. J. Eyre, that's E-Y-R-E, still available, I bought my copy on Amazon. What it makes a really clear picture for is that it's actually the vegetation that largely determines what kind of soil, also pedosphere as it's called, what the texture will be and the structure will be. So you can have the same soil and put a grassland on it. So we'll start off with the glacier's gone. We come along this time and we decide whether there's going to be a grassland or a forest on it. One forest would be a broadleaf forest, one forest might be a conifer forest, and we'll put a ryegrass pasture on one, and we'll put a prairie, mixed species prairie on another. Each of those different plant communities will induce various changes in the pedosphere. They'll basically create the soil that exists and that then we're left with. So that would be the two primary pieces. There's another book that's recently come out called Geotherapy, and that has a whole list of papers, scientific manual. It was released a couple of years ago. That's Geotherapy by Giroux, Lark and Camp, and that's another reference that I'd put forward. And there's obviously a ton of others that are lesser or whatever, and ultimately the Agrarian's Handbook when I get to the soils chapter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when we look at our platform, our platform's the Riparians platform, and that's based upon yeoman scale of permanence. Started with, we've got climate. In our case, what we've done is we've changed the emphasis being in the whole platform from being just a physical or a scale of agricultural permanence to a scale of that's more of a triple bottom line scale, if you like, where we're looking at social and financial and energetic systems, etc., as well as the physical domains. So with climate, we look at the climate of the human as being the human mind as being something that's actually quite entrenched, and we look at ways and means in which we can change that. We look at instead of looking at it through the lens of land shape, we look at it through the lens of geography, because that's a lot broader, because it includes things like demography and geology and psychography and all sorts of other analyses, which we'll look at in a moment. Then we look at water as per yeoman's access, as opposed to farm roads, because access is a lot broader term. Forestry instead of farm trees, because trees aren't the only component of a forest. Then we look at buildings, fencing instead of subdivision, because in Australia the vernacular for fencing has been subdivision, but the vernacular more worldwide is fencing. Soils as yeoman's economy, we've added, because it's obviously something that's very important. And why we've got it at 0.9 is because anybody's economy can be destroyed or grown, I think, quicker than soil can be developed or grown. And then energy is the last thing, and energy is last, because the photon of light is the most fleeting thing that exists. So it's either captured and feeds a whole system, or it goes somewhere else through the laws of thermodynamics. So that's our scale. And if I just whiz through a bit here so that we stick to topic, unless anybody's got any questions about our platform.
We're good.
Okay. Well, I might just go to get out of here for a moment. Go to this one, the other one. Now, I sent you guys a copy of this. I haven't sent you a copy of the geography book handbook yet, because it's not completed, but it will be in the next week or so. So we'll get that to Marcy and then he'll send that out to everybody. But I will give you a preview today, because it's so close, it's not funny. And we have sent you a copy of this chapter, the climate chapter, so you will have got that. I don't know whether everyone's got that now, because I only sent it this morning. But what I wanted to just look at here was the sort of pathway to creating a land plan, if you like. And there's two sets of pathways that one needs to go on in the first instance. And so, for us, that starts with a whole series of principles, and they're both design and living principles. And I'll leave you to read through those. The reference in our climate chapter for that is section 1.02. You'll see a whole list of regenerative design and living principles. So why we've got that there is because, for us, big thing that why we've got these at the start is because they frame a lot of the ways that people are influenced to design and interact with the projects that they're developing. So the more design and living principles that you have in your toolkit, in your mental toolkit or otherwise, the better you will be able to design, because if you are just stuck in the permaculture design framework, for example, well then, you know, that'll be good, but it'll be still be fairly limited. Whereas if you add to it a whole lot of other design principles that other methodologies or modalities have developed, all that then only broadens your approach and gets you out of some sort of straitjacket, even though something like permaculture is quite broad. We then look at, with that as being a sort of attitude, if you like, that we bring to the table. We then bring that something that Alan Savory developed and colleagues back in the 70s and 80s, and that's called the holistic context. And we've got some tools in there for the to help you with the development of the holistic context. I'll just go down to those. And so with that, can you see that on the screen now? I don't know how quickly.
Yeah, we can see it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, cool. So the first thing that one would do then is bring together all of the decision makers and then determine what the resource base is, determine what money is available and the sources of money, and then ask the questions of quality of life.
The screensaver problem. On the computer is wrong.
No, computer is good. Sorry, Darren, the TV cut out here for a second, just a second. Something happened on a TV screensaver. How do we prevent it from happening again?
We were talking for a while.
There you go. Yeah. Sorry, Darren. Can you maybe go back about one or 2 minutes right after
quality of life?
Quality of life questions, yeah. Darren, can you hear us?
So, you might be able to hear, but we can't hear him, maybe.
Darren, we can't hear you.
How did we get the sound? Before the sound wasn't going through, should we be doing something?
Once it was on our computer, it was fine.
Oh, okay.
He seems to have. Darren, are you speaking? Can you speak?
He's got his volume.
Darren, did you mute yourself or something? Or?
No.
Maybe take the HDMI cable out to see if the volume goes on the computer at least. Let's see, maybe the volume's not coming through.
Can you help? Can you do something? Can you help?
I don't know.
Is there a way you can type
it into try to take this out. If the volume shows up on the computer, then we know at least
it's
on
the TV.
Darren, can you speak? He's not able to hear him.
Can you do a screen share with him and type a note on a little pad and say, did you mute yourself?
He was speaking.
He said he didn't.
Oh, right. Okay.
Can you hear us, Darren?
That's on his machine.
Speaking right in your voice.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you hear us?
Yeah.
I can hear you loud and clear. Okay, we can't hear him. Where? What's going on here?
You said the sound should. It's probably the computer.
Sound should blew out.
It's probably the computer though, because it. I don't know.
Yeah, because we couldn't even hear the sound of the computer when you took
it on
HDMI cable.
Let's see, it's turned power on.
The sound of the TV last time.
Is it? It's not having to do with your audio recording thing.
No.
So that doesn't make any sound. That doesn't make sound.
That doesn't have any adapter. I guess all the Macs are.
What about that three?
Which one?
Will yours or this
one?
I don't have HDMI.
You don't have that one?
Oh, someone heard that?
Yeah. Heard something.
He says, cool, checked his settings, it should all be good. There was a sound.
Should we maybe try to hang up the call and call again?
Yeah, you can just hang it up and maybe just try it again. And then just click on it again. Okay, just click on the hangout again. Join?
She didn't make that sound when we were like.
Yeah.
Right? And it's not
like. Oh, wait, there it is. It did make that sound. Settings thing. It was for a second.
You know, could it be that?
Yeah, it's something like.
Maybe it's like with the cable.
Just like quick settings
power. Again. We will have more bandwidth. We don't need the.
Yeah, we should shut our video.
Oh wait, I hear something. I hear it real low.
And does everybody get their Wi-Fi turned off on their phones as well?
No, yeah, not on my phone.
There you go.
You hear it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's coming in and out. It's like sort of. It's an intermittent.
Hello, hello.
Hey.
Hello.
Can you hear us?
Yeah,
it's all good.
All right, we are good again.
I think so.
We
should turn off our video.
I got it. Yeah, don't worry.
All right. We've got a team of thousands there. So where were we?
We were
quality of life.
Yeah, we were on. You're talking about.
That was more. Have you got the screen back up and running and everything, and it's all good?
No screen. I guess you need to do the screen share, right?
Okay. I'll just stop and start again.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just now.
Right the name?
Yeah,
he'll get it. There you go, we have it now. Okay, share screen.
Okay.
Cool.
Is it all working?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, so off we go again. Just had my wife just sing me hello from Lionel Richie, which is in sign language, which was quite funny as a diversion, because I was singing hello so many times. Okay, so quality of life questions. That's a pretty vital piece in all of this, and that's one of the main reasons, in fact, why we include holistic management in our framework, because in so many other frameworks that are out there, the question of why you're doing this, and how do you want your life to be, and what gets you out of bed in the morning, all of those sorts of questions is not even considered. So that's a big part of why we want to get that as part of the context. We also want to know what forms of production that we're looking to provide, and those, the way holistic management, I suppose, really works in this sense is that the forms of production should be what supply the quality of life. And then further from that is the future resource base. So what sort of resources are we going to develop in the future in terms of the landscape, community, infrastructure, and even how we have seen in the community is behaving. And that extends for us into some of the discussions around the various forms of capital that are built, and people like Ethan Rowland and Greg Landway in New York, upstate New York, have developed the 8 forms of capital as a list, which would be further to read on that. So if I go back up to the top again, excuse me, and so we develop that context. So how that's manifested is typically in a list. So either if you're doing this yourself or you're working with clients, that's something that we always get them to do. So when a client comes to us, or when we recommend things to students, one of the first things we do is say, all right, we'll go and work out what your holistic context is. And that's a do-it-yourself sort of process with some coaching, perhaps. And then that really helps us to understand where people are and what they want to do, and who are the players, how much cash they've got to play with, etc. With that then comes holistic management more broadly, and HM we like to put forward as a tool for decision making and for monitoring. It ticks a lot of boxes and does so in a really really workmanlike fashion. So this is the framework for holistic management, and it's an excellent template and quite a succinct template for deciding how we're going to manage this operation called life. And so again, as you can see at the top, you've got the whole under management in the holistic context, and that's all sorted. Next thing you look at is the ecosystem processes, so look at the community dynamics or the dynamics of the organisms that are involved, the water cycle, the mineral cycle and energy flow. So you look at water cycle, what happens when a raindrop hits the ground or flood waters go over it, does it infiltrate, does it erode, etc. Mineral cycle, what happens when minerals come through our site or through our system? Do we have a phosphorus leakage? Do we have a carbon leakage, etc., or otherwise? And then energy flow, what happens when that photon of sunlight hits our landscape? Does it actually do something positive, or does it do something negative, and so on? Then we look at the various tools that we have, and we look at it from the perspective of, all right, well, these are the ways that the people conventionally make decisions around the types of tools that we might use. And then we have, as an alternative to that, a set of testing questions. So for decisions that are made, there's a series of questions that are asked, their cause and effect, identification of the weak link. Is this decision that we're taking going to sort out the social, biological and financial weak links related to that problem or decision. What's the marginal reaction? So what's the biggest, is this the biggest, we're going to get the biggest bang for buck? How does it work out from a gross profit analysis? And the gross profit you may well look at as a sustainability profit. So profit is not just financial, it's also for other forms of return. Energy and money, is it the best use? Are we developing patterns of use through this decision that are going to be positive for energy and money or negative? Is the decision sustainable? You might well ask, is it regenerative to take it to another level? And then what's the effect on society and culture? And then there's a whole series of management guidelines, some of which you're doing now, I hope, with learning and practice. And then there's organisation and leadership through the whole system or enterprise, marketing, time and stock density management, cropping, burning, population management. You know, do we have the right population of organisms at this given time for the amount of resources that are available? And then I would look at the final part there, the feedback loop. And this is a really big one for us. Is where, when we're planning, we assume that we're wrong with the environment. But that to us means, well, don't suffer from inertia by your, or get paralysis by analysis. What it does mean is that that you should take care. Don't just go out there and, as so many would do, and get the big yellow machines out on the site without going through a proper and appropriate process, because what you're likely to do is do something quite wrong. And particularly when you're managing ecologies, ecologies are incredibly complex things, and so it's very easy, as we all know, humanity's got a litany of examples where we've meddled with our ecologies, and even in a seemingly small way, and it's had vast and irreversible ramifications. Genetically modified organisms might be one example of where we're not assuming we're wrong with the environment, and we may well have some traumatic and terminal outcomes as a result. So then, when we're planning, we're also planning within our process to monitor, and then once we do our monitoring, then we have control, and then we replan, and so that's the cycle of feedback. David Holmgren, in his permaculture principles, has a similar sort of approach, although it doesn't make any assumptions about being wrong with the environment. His permaculture principle that applies here is accept feedback and apply self-regulation. And they're all listed in the principles that we've got listed at the top here. Okay, now, next piece is, go back up to the top, is some sort of climate table. So we've developed a climate table in the manual here, and for us that really gives us a very broad understanding of the, and I'll just go to it, excuse me, where are we? Too far. Here we are. So our climate table that we've developed, it's based on some work that was done by John Gladstone's in the early 2000s. He wrote a book called Viticulture and Climate, in which he was mainly trying to determine the suitability of grape varieties according to the amount of growing day degrees. So growing day degrees are the accumulated degrees above a particular minimum over the growing season of individual plants. So a date palm has a different number of day degrees required to produce dates than a tomato has, or a tomato has to produce tomatoes. So what we've done with this table is created an view with the ability to plot over a chart, a logarithmic chart, your climate from generally readily available climate figures that you can get from different organisations and bureaucracies, and then plot those, and then plot other climates which are somewhat similar or that are desirous to you in terms of the species that you have, and then with that you can come out with some outcomes about, quite holistic outcomes about your climate, and a bit of a, it can tell you what you can do and what you can't do, or what's going to be difficult. It's a bit of an elaboration, if you like, on the US-based system where you're looking at zones. You know, there's a whole range of climate zones across the US, and that's all fine, but it doesn't really tell you how many growing day degrees you've got, or how many chilling hours you've got, or how many sunshine hours you've got, or the average solar exposure, or all of those different things, your rainfalls, all of those different things that you might really need to know. So we address that there. Next thing in this pathway is, go back up, is to give yourself a broad Koppen and Geiger classification. That's not absolutely essential in this process, I think. It's more if you're communicating your site with other people. It's a common language that has been used in climate classification since the 1880s across the planet. So if we go to the next thing is, if you are working with other people, it's really important to develop memorandums of understanding, because in the planning process there may well be other consultants that are involved, or engineers, for example, architects or draftsmen, or all sorts of different people who may well be engaged. And so having very clear memorandums of understanding is important, to be clear with what you want and what your cost ceilings are, etc. And then regulatory frameworks. So understanding within all of this the regulatory frameworks that exist, so that you can determine what you can and can't do. Now, I think some of you will have known will know of the work of Joel Salatin. One of the books he put out years ago was Everything That I Want to Do is Illegal, and which I think the subtitle was War Stories from the Local Food Front. And that book is full of examples of where people like Joel and others are pushing the envelope as insofar as acting through a form of civil disobedience to irrational regulations in this space. So that's something to look at as well. And just how far you're prepared to go with your particular context. And then we have a checklist. So the checklist is at the base of this document, and it's a pro forma that we've developed. Got that here in a separate chart. And I don't think I shared this with you specifically, but I will. So what we've got here is, this is for both, it's designed for both self-use and also if you are a consultant. And it goes through all of the questions. So basically every section and every question that we have within the Riggarian's Handbook is more or less covered in this checklist. And so you could send this to a client, or you could just sit down amongst yourselves and fill this out for a particular site, and you'll have covered most of the bases that you need to cover. It's pretty comprehensive. So that's where you. So when you're setting yourself up for the next steps in this whole process of land planning, you really, like I say, you need a good foundation. And for us, with the 25 years of work that we've done in this field, this is where we've come to. And these are some of the templates and processes that we use. So let's get our mind right, and let's get all of our facts on the table, and let's get our attitude known, and our life's desires understood. And now we'll move to looking at the landscape, which is often where people actually start. And so that's our next chapter, which, as I mentioned, is unfinished. And I'll just halt for a moment and see if anybody's got any questions.
Can we get that checklist? I think it's part of the checklist.
The checklist, Darren, is in the chapter?
Not the whole checklist. I will send you... We did a checklist for climate, but we've actually got a whole checklist which goes through all of the Regrarians platform, and I'll share that with you separately. I've just got to put it up on Dropbox, and we've only just done that, so I'll put that up on Dropbox and send that through. So you'll get that and the geography chapter.
Okay. Thank you. I have another question. Some people were offended by the large... My question is, some people were offended by the large weeds on our site. To me, it's actual excellence in terms of resource extraction from deeper soils. What's your opinion on that?
Yep. Well, I call weeds plants, for a start, so that might give you some initial indication is into my attitude towards plants and the use of the derogatory term weed, which I think is it's a pejorative term that's you, it sort of indicates to me at times a lack of eco-literacy or agro-literacy as might sometimes. So I mean, any plant that exists of its own accord is doing so because it's indicating a set of conditions that have been afforded either by human intervention or other forms of intervention. And so if you've got thistles across your whole site, for example, I'm not going to look at that and go, oh gee, you've got a lot of thistles, you need to spray it out or you need to do something about it. My first inquiry would be, or my first mental note would be, right, I've got an excess of nitrogen here and I'm really happy I've got thistles because they're subsoil to 3 meters. So, and I've not found a subsoiling plough that can plough to 3 meters in 1 year and leave, if I manage it properly, a great residue of carbon as a result. So, you know, I get the sort of some of the problems that there are with some plants and how they've imposed themselves on landscapes, but we've also got to take a big step back and ask the questions of why have they got there and what are they telling us? Mm-hmm. And recognise too that it's a representation of the continuation of human hubris to impose our values on the expression of other species at times. What are we to know better than a thistle?
Thank you.
So, any other questions at all? All right, well, move on with geography. And this will answer quite a few of the other questions that we've got. Now, when we look at the questions of the basics of land planning and architectural, I'm not a landscape architect and I'm not going to pretend that I am, and nor am I going to really represent it in this discussion other than saying this, that landscape architecture is largely... or has become largely the enterprise of designing less functional landscapes and more landscape systems that are there for more aesthetic pleasures than for pure function. And that's something I don't do. like people say to me, bring me Tuscany, Darren, you know, or design me Tuscany or something like that, or la la. Well, when I look at a Tuscan landscape, what people find very appealing about that particular landscape is actually an agro-ecological landscape. Sure, there are some elements to it in the way that particular lines have been developed into it, or architectural lines and architectural principles, but broadly it's an agro-ecological zone that they're trying to impart on a different climate or place. And so it's it therefore creates a framework of themes and landscape themes. I've worked on many properties that have been designed, and I've worked with landscape architects, so I do have some understanding of the discipline. I've had the pleasure of working on landscapes that were designed by the great Capability Brown, who is reputed to be one of the first landscape architects in the 1750s in the UK. One of my clients has got a 16,000 acre estate in just an hour out of London, and it was all developed by Capability Brown, and it's astounding. And for a person of his time, it was somewhat functional, but at the same time, a lot of it was about aesthetics, and you sort of missed a lot of opportunities as a result of making a much more functional landscape that reflected the ultimate needs of the site, and the production system, not just the aesthetics of the lord involved at the time, and subsequently. So, that said, there are a number of landscape architects that we've worked with who, like myself, have been quite broad, and so what they've done is they've become basically farm planners, and so they've used the tools of farm planning and land planning to do their work. And I know a number of landscape architects who've more or less left their present profession behind and just work as land planners now. Yeah, they certainly bring some of that here, the way that they approach the process of design, and also in the way that they can communicate the design, because a part of the landscape architecture training is the ability to be able to, or building the ability to be able to do fantastic illustrations and cross sections and rendering and all the rest of it. So it's certainly a big part of it. But from us, as I've given you some of the basics of our approach, and I guess that's why I've been asked to talk today, is we patterned an approach which has been quite successful, not just with us, but with many others. So I'll continue on that frame. So we've developed an understanding around the climate of the property and the project. We now look at the geography, and with this, this is quite detailed. The climate chapter took us about a month and a half to produce. And we released that in March. It's now nearly the end of July, and we're just about finished the geography chapter, so that gives you some sort of indication as to the complexities that are involved in getting all of this together. So when we look at the geography layer, we have to start with cartography, and because cartography is where we're pulling together all of the data into a set of layers, and so that we understand a whole lot about the geography of an area and the site that we're working within. We put in here Keyline because Keyline for us is a set of geographic-based parameters and also systems and patterns that we apply within geography. It's sort of like the framework. And quite broadly, if you look at the development of the permaculture design theory from its genesis with Mollison and Holmgren, they admit quite freely that they based a lot of what they did on the Keyline design framework. As yeomans had been quite prominent well before here in Australia, well before permaculture was even a thought. So then we've got a series of land analysis tools that we use. So we're looking at the land, and what I mean by the land is quite broadly. And then we look at the sites, that's where we come in quite closely. And then even further, we look at organising the survey of the land and what sort of techniques are we going to use. Why surveying is down the list from, say, cartography is because we don't decide on what kind of survey we'll do until we've gone through a bit of process as we've got above in from 2, 3, and 4. And then we look at monitoring, what type of monitoring systems will we have to make sure that what we're doing is actually working or not, and where we go from there. So I'll continue now. So has anybody got any questions?
We got through more detail of the Keyline patterns we should look for here.
So the question is
more on that, or?
Question is, are you going to go into more details of the Keyline patterns?
Absolutely, because it's on my brief here, Marcin, and I'm very dedicated to the brief you've given me, mate.
Thanks.
Clearly.
Clearly. Okay. Well, I'll skim through some of this because you will have a copy. So this is a map. So again, I think you can see that we're reading through a manual here that sort of gives you, in some cases, what might be superfluous information, and then also gives you some sort of a manual for how to put things together. So when we look at cartography, there is a way that we put a map together. There are symbols used, there are conventions used, and so what we've got is an understanding of that. And then the types of maps that you might well look to, both viewing as part of your analysis, your cartographic analysis, and also maps that you might produce yourself as an output. And this is where people like, classes like this are looking at the use of GIS platforms, because GIS platforms unleash the power of geography to create all of these different forms of analysis that aren't just pictures on a map, but aren't just the physical features of maps. They're also analysis that comes from geography as you've got through these analysis of these various thematic maps that we've got on the page there. And even, you know, these isorhythmic maps and all the rest of it. Understanding the way maps work is also important, and that's why we've got in here an understanding around magnetic declination, particularly if you're doing any survey work, all of that sort of thing. I won't go into this because I'm sure Stefano has done an amazing job so far in talking about GIS and all that sort of thing, particularly as relates to the QGIS program and platform. But I will just go through and show the layers, or some of the layers that of data that we are looking for and typically do source as part of our investigation of any site. So we obviously can get, if you look at the bottom layer, we can obviously get very good imagery these days of sites from places like Google Earth and Bing and others. Municipalities, we can get good topographic mapping typically of everywhere now. Mostly generated using photogrammetry and more recently using LIDAR that's available publicly. Your cadastral information, so all the property boundaries, tax parcels, road reserves, easements, all of those sorts of things, existing land use, water features, survey controls if you're going to the stage of the, to that stage, where are the survey controls that you can reference to find your place very accurately. Land capability classes and soil mapping and all of that sort of thing. Well, the NRCS have got a bounty of all of that sort of information available to you lucky folks in the US. And then you've got your client data, and that's the data that you yourself have sort of established through site analysis primarily, and we'll talk about that tomorrow. So when we look at the development of a base map, for us, our primary base map is where we've got a aerial photo overlaid with a contour map, and we'll print that out typically onto a I'll have to use another section of here to describe in our paper sizes. We'd be looking at a B size, so a ledger or a tabloid size print. This is the American language over here, and this is the international language on the left, in terms of paper sizes. So we'll print something out on that size, or even up to a C size plan. That's as big as we'll do really to take something out in the field, because if you make any bigger, even when it's laminated, it's not workable. It gets picked up by the wind and all the rest of it. We only do the really large format plans when we're doing stuff on a desktop, or when we're putting something on the board. Now, the next thing I've got in here as part of the process is the process with design, and this starts really when you're out in the field walking around checking things out, is the development of concepts. And particularly, we have a pretty strong relationship between our concept planning and cross sections. Cross sections are a really great way of getting your head around how you're going to fit things in spatially and three-dimensionally, and how they'll interact with each other, as I'll talk about further as we go along through here. It's not until you have really gone through those processes, through the iterations of those processes, that then you start to really come down to develop a detailed plan or detailed plans. Another thing that's really useful to do, and this is why we've created standard, is nice. Is standard line styles and patterns, so that when you ledge and plant, you've got a really good set. And we've developed our own set based on the Gregorian's platform, which are listed there, which you can take or leave it. Now, I think, Stefano, have you dealt with geographic projection and all of that sort of thing?
Yes, today we have to introduce it, yes.
Yep. So you've dealt with all of these different projection systems, etc. Yep.
Yeah, we haven't gotten into the details of everything, but we have done the general concept, mm-hmm. So we should be a bit familiar.
Perfect. Yeah. Okay, now the other thing is when you're deciding what contour interval to use on particular maps. We've developed this schematic here, which for us helps you decide what contour interval to use on particular scale, on particular slopes. So if your property is, if much of the property that or project site that you're working on is 10 to 20 degrees of slope, then a 50 centimetre map, a 50 centimetre or what's that, 2 foot contour map should suffice for most purposes. As you get to being quite a flat site, then you might need to go right down to a 4-inch contour map, and so on. So that's what we've got there. Yeah.
Just a question now. So in our farm here, how many hectares or acres we have?
30 acres.
It's about 30 acres, and I think the overall difference level will be something like 20 meters, so it's quite flat. So the slopes could be some specific areas quite steep. So what you could recommend, we should just look into your graphic and find out something about, because until now I've done like a meter resolution contour line.
Yeah, if you've got a meter, I would think that a meter, a half meter to 1 meter for a site like that would be fine.
Great, yeah, that's what I thought. And all right, great, thank
and,
you.
And question, Stefano, because what happens with maps as well is that you might start with a half meter or a 2 foot contour map, and then what you do is once you become really familiar with your site and the use of that map, you might bring it back to a 1 or even 2 meter contour map, because you've got so many lines across the page that it becomes too busy to look at.
Right, yeah. They will
and
seem a little bit
so busy. What we'll often do is we'll often have a 50 centimeter contour layer, and we'll have a 1 meter contour layer, and we'll have a 2 meter contour layer, and we'll turn each of those layers off or on, depending on the on what we're doing with that particular map.
Great, thank you.
Yeah. Now let's talk about Keyline. So I won't read through all of these because that'll be really boring for you, but what we'll do is I'll just refer to this section here in this page 19 here as being a page in which we've described all of the geographic elements within Keyline, and so you can read through that in your own time, but let's have a look at the geographic elements in place. So what we've done is developed this a 5-series maps that describe the Keyline geography in place. And so first part of that is well, you can see this little orange landscape here. See that just there? That's what we call the home landscape. And so we'll zoom in closer and closer to that. So when we look at a whole catchment, we can see it's composed of ridges and valleys and creeks and rivers, etc. So we've started at the ocean, we've got the estuary, we've got the river, and then we've got a series of creeks and then secondary valleys which feed into those creeks. And so they're the main forms of water flow. Then when we zoom in a bit closer, we can start to see that the landscape takes on, that we identify other parts of the landscape or other components or elements to the landscape. And so if you were to look at your fist, you would see that you have, if you were to put a line across your knuckles, then that would constitute what in a landscape is the main ridge. And these solid black lines in this map are what represent the main ridge. They're the horizons of landscapes, the roofs of landscapes, or the apex of the roofs, the ridge capping. And then off that is your fingers. So if your fist, if you like, if your knuckles are the main ridge, then your fingers are the ridges. And then the space in between your fingers are the valleys. And so on it goes. So that's what we've identified there. Let's come in a bit closer where it's a bit clearer. So we've got a main ridge running through here. So they become the boundaries of catchments, of sub-catchments, of what I would call primary catchments. And off that then come the fingers. So you've got the knuckles, and then you've got the fingers, and then you've got the valleys within in between the fingers. So in Keyline, this is called, the dark line is called the main ridge. These fingers are called the primary ridges because they're the first ridges, and then you've got the primary valleys that go between them, and then primary valleys join in some systems, not all, but in some systems join to become a secondary valley, and then when two secondary valleys meet, that's when it becomes a creek. So you go, what you're doing here is you're defining stream orders. So if you look at the stream orders involved here, we've got the raindrop, which is the first stream order or flow order, and then we've got the rill, and then we've got the runnel, and then we've got a primary valley, then we've got the secondary valley, the creek, the river, the estuary, the ocean. They're the seven orders of flow in a landscape, and they're the seven orders of flow within our body. So the heart is the ocean, the aorta is the estuary, the veins are the rivers, and, you know, you go right out to the cell is the raindrop. And the same in trees, it's the dendritic pattern of flow. Now, what you'll notice in these maps is that we've got these little red bits identified, and the dots are what's key points of the valleys. So the key points are where the valley changes in form from being flat, or where it stops being flat. So if you go up a primary valley, there'll be a point at which the floor of the valley will go from being a deposition zone to being an erosion zone. So it'll go from being more or less flat to being convex, and that's revealed in a, if you go up this valley, you can, up this valley, you can see that the contours are quite wide apart, and then right at this point they start to close, and that suggests that the, right at that point there's been a rising slope, and so that's where the key point is. So you go from erosion to deposition at that point. The contour which goes through the key point, or is of the key point, is called the key line. And they have varying shapes, sizes and lengths. But their lengths are determined by where the ridge starts and the valley ends. So if you look at this one, for example, over here, I'll just change colour.
Do you think you could zoom in on the graphic you're drawing on right now?
Yep. Oh, sure.
Thank you.
No problem at all. Is that better?
Yeah. Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, beautiful.
Yeah.
So if we look at, if you look at right here and here, now if you look at the valley has the shape which is a concave curve, and then a ridge has a convex curve. So the point at which that changes is where the valley ends and the ridge starts. And conversely, in key line, that's where the key line ends. So the key line is appropriately known as the key line of the valley. And unfortunately, there's been many people who particularly in the permaculture movement, in their trainings, who suggested that the key line actually extends not only out onto the ridge, but is of the same elevation from valley to valley to valley, which it's not, and it never can be, because it's just not geographically possible. Because of the natural work. I'll talk about next. So,
okay.
Sorry, Darren.
Can you
go on?
Can you repeat that concept again? I think we missed it here.
So, can you repeat your main point of that you just said? I think.
I've said that. Yeah, that's okay. So, in Keyline, what a lot of people have done, in particularly in permaculture, the permaculture movement, there's been a number of books, and I'll name some of them: the Permaculture Designer's Manual, Introduction to Permaculture, Mark Shepherd's, what's his book called?
Restoration
Agriculture. the Earth Care Manual by Patrick Whitefield and a number of others have made very mistaken claims about what Keyline is and at its cost. And so we're seeking to correct that through this manual. But one of the primary things that they get wrong is that the Keyline actually extends out to a ridge, which it doesn't, or that Keylines and key points are all on the same elevation, which they are not. Now, there's a simple reason for that. The reason for a start why key points are not on the same elevation is just a simple matter of geography. If you look at this particular map, I'll just give you those points. If you look at this particular map, what you'll notice is that this point up here is higher than this point here. See the con? So that's a main ridge. And as we go down this line, the contours are falling in that direction. And they continue to fall. So each of the crests are of a different elevation. And so therefore, each of these saddles in between each of these crests is of a different elevation. But these crests have a descending relationship to each other. And they will continue to descend until that ridge becomes a valley or a creek or a river or something, right? Now, with that, there is each of these valleys that come off this main ridge have different elevations too. And so, therefore, so do the key lines, the key points. So this point here in this valley is on this contour. Right? So it's the highest key point in this particular series of four because of its relationship to the main ridge above it, which is descending in that direction. So if the main ridge is descending in that direction, then so do the key points descend in that direction. So does all of the water move in that direction. That's just something that happens all over the planet because of gravity. So this one here is on this contour. This one here is on this contour. And so on. So they all have each of these key points and each of these key lines are on different elevations. Now, again, in some of these permaculture books in particular, I'm singling out permaculture because I've done a pretty extensive literature review. It's really only permaculture that in the contemporary sense talks much about Keyline, unfortunately. And permaculture, to a large extent, has appropriated Keyline as a system. But in many ways, a lot of people have actually got it quite wrong. So if I was some permaculturalist, well, then I would identify one key point, and then that would be the Keyline. And that would be the line on which I would put, in most cases, something called a swale, which is a level ditch on contour. I think Mark Shepherd called this the sweet spot in the landscape on a ridge, and so on. Now, if I was to do that, then what I'm doing is, this is the key line here for this particular valley, but the key line and the key point, this one is lower, much lower. And so what I'm doing is I'm creating these lines that are okay for a small amount of area, but once I get out onto here, the slope starts to increase. I'm now no longer in a deposition zone, I'm in an erosion zone. and so on. And so it becomes a suboptimal place to do all sorts of things. We saw this years ago with a project that Jeff Lawton did for Milkwood, very similar landscape to this actually, in which he found a key point and then did a swale that went for quite a distance, and he built a pond in each of these, or in a number of these valleys. And that's all good, except that this pond was okay because he was able to find adequate clay at that point. But when he got out to here, because he'd stuck on that contour and he was now out here, he was actually on erosion landscape where there was very little clay, because clays in many cases are formed below the key lines, below the key points, because that's where water goes to and you get the mechanical weathering of larger soil particles until they become clay. You get the mechanical, biological, chemical weathering of material so that it becomes clay, which is the smallest soil particle. So in this case, this dam was a failure because it didn't have enough clay, and that was simply because of this particular approach, and that's called Keyline by some people. That's wrong. So I just needed to get that out there. Now let's move along so that we get through things.
We have a couple of questions, please.
Yeah.
Yep.
Darren, can we review just a little bit? So to summarize, the definition of key point is everyone getting key point definition?
I've got another drawing, so let's get to that.
Yeah, the inflection point.
Like that's this point right
here. Yeah, the cross section of the inflection point would be helpful.
Here we are.
Yeah.
So here we look at the cross section of a slope. So if you look at the point of inflection, that's where the shape goes from convex to concave, right? Well, a valley is not necessarily concave. It's flat or it's descending. It's not like a bowl. If that were the case, then water would never make it to the creek. So that part there is convex. That part there between the point of inflection and the key point is concave. But above that, it's convex, and below that, once we get to the key point, it's descending. It's flat. It's got a straight trajectory. With the natural undulations that occur in landscapes. So that's the key point, and then when you look at that, take that cross section and put that onto the map, you can also see that the shape of the contour there is quite different to the ones above and below it, and that's what's special about the key line, is that it's a very special line. That one, it identifies where you would put the water of a pond in that primary valley, but it also, if you plough parallel to it or plant trees parallel to it or otherwise, both above and below it, then you'll always get water moving away from the centre of the valley. So it's not that it's pushing water uphill. As you can see, these parallel lines to the key line are actually crossing contours. So the key line's on contour, every other one's not on contour. And so they're falling in their way. And this diagram here that I've put together explains that even better, I think. So, and how you use these patterns, and this will help us with our planting design question. Imagine that we had a site that we wanted to establish trees onto. Or row crops or else, and we wanted to use the key line pattern, which I think the best that we can use. Then what we've got is we've got a ridge which is falling in the opposite direction to the one that we showed before. So you can see it's falling. I might change colour. the ridge is falling in this direction. Okay, the creek is falling in that direction. Okay, that key point is higher than that key point. So that key point is on this, on the 80 contour. The next key point is on the 70 contour. So the first thing that I do is I put on, and this is not what Yeoman suggested, this is my own concept. First thing I do is identify the valley shape. So where does the valley start and end? Okay, and that's why I put that line through there. The next thing I do is I mark the key line. So I find the key point, and you can see as I've come up the valley here, that's the, that line there, that contour, is the one that's, that is the last contour before it starts to, all, they all start to close. See those contours there are quite close together, and these ones are quite far apart. So that's suggesting that right at that point is where we're going from being quite steep, you can see through,
yeah,
to quite gentle. Right, and it also suggests that from here it's erosion, here it's deposition. Okay, so we come back to here. Now the next step in the, this is we find in a map the lowest contour of a primary ridge. So we've gone through, I couldn't get this last 51. If I had more map, I probably would have got that, but you'll see I've got that. They're all on a contour, just for the purposes of illustrating with this map. So we find that. The next step in this, that's what we've marked green, is that we make a parallel line to this ridge contour, and we go up from that contour with that. And we keep going up until we meet the key line. Right? Now the key line's here, but what we've done is we've just put one contour, we put one line parallel below the key line in order for us to be able to find a meeting point. Right? So that's there. And then we've done the same on this one. And this one's actually been able to, these lines we put parallel to the ridges, these ridges have been able to meet the key line, not an offset of the key line. Now the reason for that is, the next diagram is so that we can create a contiguous line through the landscape that is parallel to the key line, to the respective key lines of the respective primary valleys, and is also parallel to the lowest ridge contours in each of the respective primary ridges. That then gives us a pattern that we can work with in what's called pattern cultivation. And so that's what leads us to here, where we've now made parallel lines to that dotted line that we've got running through the landscape there. Now you'll notice that each of these contour lines, or each of these cultivation lines, are all falling from the valley, because here's the valleys, right? And these are all falling towards the ridge, each and every one of them. And that's part of the pattern genius of the keyline pattern cultivation. I'll keep going with this. I've got more drawings which will reinforce the concepts here. And then the next piece in this is what we do is we then, in order to respect the fact that we will have a turning area at the end of each row, we calculate the turning radius of the machinery that's most commonly going to be used on this site. I just worked with Owen Hablitzel, a keyline designer I've trained on a project in Texas the other day. He's designing a 230-acre pecan orchard. And so we worked out that there's a 70-foot headland required what's this turning area required because of the kinds of machinery that are used to harvest pecans. So that's quite a big headland that we're, so in the case of that particular design, this spacing here is 70 feet, right? And so we put this, I don't know, Stefano, you know, if in QGIS you can do what's called a parallel offset. I think I did ask you that before.
Parallel offset?
A parallel offset.
I double check. I guess yes. I haven't done it, but we will look through that. If you find
I'll show you an example here in MapInfo of what a parallel offset. MapInfo is the program I use.
Okay. Yes.
So if I draw a line, so let's say I'll just move out of here a moment. So let's say I want to do a little key line pattern over in here. So I'll just make a line, get a line. Actually, right there is a key point. That looks like a key point to me. So I'll make a little key line in here. Goes down to the ridge.
Can you use a heavier line? Can hardly see it.
Yeah, I will. Yeah, you will. You'll see it. See that?
Yep.
Yeah. Right. So what I'll do is I'll select that. Now what I'll use is this tool here. It's a create parallel. And I'll create a parallel that's... I'll make that pink or red. Okay. And I'll make it on both sides of that. All right, so see how that has made those two parallel lines?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right, now I can continue that, or if I want to, like I said before, create a parallel off this fence, which shows, so if I want to put a parallel off this fence, show me.
We can do that, yeah.
Right. I'll put that parallel in, and now that becomes my headland. So if I was to bring this up to here, for example, and you can see the keyline pattern at work there. See how this point here. This point here. You can see that this point here is higher than this point here. This point here is higher than this point here. So this line is.
Darren, can you zoom in a little bit? Or
yeah, sure. So you can see that this point here is higher. So there's a contour, this black contour, which is running through here. And I've got a line which is parallel to the key line, which is down here, this green one. And because I've dragged it up, it's still parallel with that initial line, but it's now falling in this direction. And falling in this, and it's, see that point there is lower than that point there. So if water is to flow across this landscape, it's going to get collected by this tree line. And it's going to fall towards the dry ridge, away from the wet valley. And that's part of the genius of Keyline, is that once you establish this understanding, then you can get a much more even flow of water across the whole landscape, if that's what you want to do. It really helps to bring water under control. But then using this parallel offset function allows you to then, if you're at this point, and, well, I don't want to go any, you know, I need to have a turning radius right here at the end of this row, then what I'll do is get this line and take off a node and drag it back to there.
What about,
and so the next row I
copy that line along that the horizontal line.
The next
copying that line along whatever the river or whatever the river. You can copy and use a reference the line which watches that line. The river line. The red line, the valley.
The red one? That's the boundary.
The boundary. Like if you copy that line, it will be, the distance will be exact.
Yeah, that's what he did.
Instead of offsetting.
He just did an offset, so he just told
but
it.
Offsetting
what?
The line to
he told it what dimension, and then it just went and offset the line to
that,
what dimension he wanted.
Okay, that will be a little bit, you see, if you offset that line, it will go exactly behind. But he wanted it to be in this.
I had a question on. Could I ask a question on using those parallel lines?
Yeah, sure.
That bottom section where you have the three pink lines, it seems like those are dropping in height very quickly. Using the parallel line method, how do you take into account issues like the erosion characteristics of that soil type or the, you know, magnitude of rainfall events?
Yeah, that's a very common question. Yes, you do have to consider aggregate rainfall events. So, you know, what's the heaviest rainfall you'll ever get, all of that. And that's why we start with climate, so that we've got all of those clear understandings. That's sort of in the back of our mind. The other thing that we want to know is what sort of soil have we got, how erosive is it? But also what sort of treatments are we going to put in place. So, for example, we will typically not recommend people establish a permanent row crop system or tree crop system until they've gone through some time of soil renovation. And so what that'll sometimes mean is 2 or 3 years of soil renovation prior to planting any trees, any row crops. And we'll typically do that whilst using a pastoral system over the top of that, because pasture and works beautifully with keyline pattern cultivation. And as we go back to what I talked about before with the relationship between vegetation and soils, if you want to rapidly increase organic carbon levels and soil structure, well, then pastures, grass species, are the best species to do that. That's why the plains of the US have some of the best soils in the world, is because they've been grasslands forever, right? And so that's produced a particular kind of soil and soil texture and soil drainage. And it wasn't until you guys started to abuse that through the cultivation of annual crops as Europeans, that those soils really started to fall apart. So we will go through that process, and that's a process that we've done at our place, for example. Our place, if I had have had gradients and, like of the sort that we're talking about here, we've got some, in some cases 15 degree gradients of fall from the center of the valley out towards the ridge, right?
Wow.
Which is a pretty significant gradient, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, I wouldn't ordinarily contemplate doing that because it would cause erosion if my soil wasn't capable of managing that, right? And so that's why when you're talking keyline, you really got to think about this from a systems perspective. Don't go and just take keyline and put these patterns in without improving your soil first. And again, that's some of the detail that's been missing in the discussion around keyline. Keyline is a whole system, and I really mean that. And Yeoman's made this point in the Challenge of Landscape that he got 14 inches of rain over 2 weeks, which doesn't matter where you are in the world, that's a substantial amount of rain. And when you get 14 inches of rain, that's typically in pretty heavy rolling events, right? Now, he had found that because he had keyline plowed, back then using just a simple chisel plow, that he got absolutely no runoff. Even though he had some of these patterns which were 15 to 20 degrees away from the center of the valley in fall to the ridge through the use of the keyline pattern. So the rationale there being is that because you're absorbing the raindrop as it falls, and you're doing that to a depth of soil structure that can absorb it, even in quite poorly, and in our case and in Yeoman's case, soaking soils, which themselves are dispersive. If you do that, then it doesn't matter. The slope really doesn't matter. So someone like Grant Schultz, for example, at Versaland, in his interpretation of keyline, one of the things that he did was, and I know Grant, he's a friend, and I've been to his property. One of the things that he did was he didn't go through the process of soil renovation before he put in his widely spaced agroforestry system over 140 acres. And so what he did was he put a limit of fall on his so-called key lines of 5 degrees, because just as you asked, he was trying to limit the amount of erosion potential, and that's fair, and get that, but I wouldn't call it keyline because it's not a whole system that he's applied. If he was doing keyline, then he would have renovated the soil for a couple of years ahead of time, and then he would have had equidistant patterns applied where he wouldn't have been so concerned about the relative fall. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, just one last thing.
Sure.
Would you say, in potentially in his case, for doing the grass restoration, perhaps the ripping method of spreading out water would be necessary? That would, you find that usually safe to do?
Do
the plow work
first? I've only found it to be, say if you've got extremely dispersive soils, class 1 or 2 dispersive soils, that some form of chemical amendment may well be necessary, and you've got to review the situation. So if you're in a landscape which is, say, completely, but has a very low level of ground cover, existing ground cover, then it may be wise for you to change that at the first instance, and so that would mean more shallow cultivation as opposed to ripping, and getting that surface cover, because surface cover is the most important thing to get done. It doesn't matter, you know, if you're going to do anything, just get 100% ground cover 100% of the time. That's the first rule of all of this. The second port of call, of course, once you've done that, is then to look at, if you've got landscapes which are incredibly sodic, that's where there's excess sodium ions or cations which are replacing which are displacing the calcium ions on the clay particle. Well, then there's very little capacity when the soil is wet for the clays to actually aggregate. They disperse. And so when you've got that situation, we will often look at applying something like gypsum or lime, for that matter, to help to chemically change that situation. And then we'll look at starting to do our ripping and all of that sort of thing. So, as with most things, you need to have a bit of understanding about what's going on, and there's no silver bullets. You've got to look at, well, how can we get to where we want to go? But you can't always just go in ripping. You've got to understand your situation a bit more wholly. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it seems that some of the slopes we're talking about seem very cavalier, but I believe you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's
the other thing is too, I would say, is that, if we look at soil conservation methods that have been used for a long time, most of them have used, they've discharged water down into grassed valleys. And in some cases, those valleys themselves have been quite a slope index. And so what you've done is you've pulled water off a whole ridge, and then you've discharged it into a primary valley.
Yeah.
And that has caused quite a lot of erosion, because the valley itself is it's got a relative slope, which it shouldn't have that amount of water flowing over it in a concentrated event. So, whereas what we found is that most ridges, and I'm being very general here, most ridges actually have better drained soils than most valleys do. And so it's if you do this in the right way, I can't place enough emphasis on the right way here, and I think I've made that the right way fairly clear, that we're not trying to be cavalier. What we're trying to be is diligent. Is that when you get water out onto a ridge, it has a much higher capacity to absorb that water, because of generally on a ridge, the subsurface rock is closer to the surface, and it's often fractured because of the nature of geomorphology, and so the water's able to absorb a lot better on the ridge. So there's those sorts of factors as well. But one of the most important things that I would say out of all of this is, don't get too hung up on the patterns here from the get-go. Get hung up on 100% ground cover 100% of the time.
We have another question?
Yeah, I'm going to go a little bit more on the pattern, I guess. I don't want to get too hung up, but have you ever considered,
I don't mind getting hung up on keyline patterns, because it's one of my favorite topics.
All right, thank you. So what if you had your rows were kind of maybe start off with the keyline, but then are gradually influenced by the contours? Has that...
Yeah. Well, look, again, what you can do, I'll take you to this section here, for example. Where will I take you with this? I'll take you over here. The way things usually work, I'll just zoom out on this. The way things usually work when you're setting trees out or setting out rows on landscape is how you do it in what we call segments, right? Or sections. So here's one ridge, right? Well, it's not even the whole ridge, because the next ridge is owned, some of this ridge is owned by the next landholder, right? Now, this is not uncommon. and what you can see is, I don't have a key point. I don't have a key line in this area at all. The key point is down here, and yes, I could use it, but the valley ends about here, right? And Then I've got another little valley shape which sort of extends through here, and the ridge shape sort of goes around here, right? And this is where the rubber hits the road with all of this stuff, okay? And so it ties very much into both of the questions that have been asked, I think. In that, if we look at the distance, what I've got up here is a saddle, right? And so I've got a contour through here, and then broadly, valley sort of falls through here, and then I've got another valley that's falling through here, and they're coming together through here, okay? With the key point being around about here, perhaps. That's where it starts to flatten, or probably right here. That's where it starts to flatten out. You can see these contours all start to really flatten out here. Now, what I've done is I've looked at this contour here, and I've gone, okay, well, I'll make from that. So I've made herring bone, right? Where I've got a little bit of fall. You can see this contour. I'll just get rid of some of those lines. I've got this contour running through here. Right? And so what I've done is I've started here, and then I've run through here, and then I've fallen back that way a bit. So I've gone a little bit below the contour here, I've gone a little bit above the contour here, and then I'm falling back. And then I've paralleled off that. Now, if you look at the fall that I've got across this slope here, in actuality, it's less than about 5 degrees, right? So it's sort of applying a rule that some people have talked about, Cam Wilson, myself, Grant Schultz, other sort of people. Let's try and keep a minimum of about a 5 degree fall on any of these lines. Now you can see at about this point, right through here, the landscape actually changes a bit. Can you see how the lines start to get a bit flatter? We've got a very defined sort of ridge form starting to happen through here, etc. And that's what happens in landscapes. And so what we've done there is we've kept with the pattern that we've got here, but then what I've done is I've put a new line through here. And I started that line actually down here. So you have to follow through with me in the way that I've done this, which would be obviously a separate session, but you'd have to follow through the method that I've followed here to understand how I've got to that reckoning. And one of the things that we do is, as I've done in this case, is I've done this probably about 3 or 4 times until I've been satisfied that I've got the right shape and that I haven't had too great a falls. But I've also, but I've still always had some fall. Because you'll see here, in most cases, I've only crossed one contour in each of these lines. Which for this particular slope is about 5 degrees.
Can you go over into the tree? Now
that exactly what I've described here, but because I haven't taken you through the process completely, but that gives you a sort of a broad understanding.
Can you go over some of the trade-offs that led you to this design, or some of your, just maybe just a quick like narrative about it?
Trade-offs. I don't think I really have any. The basic parameter that you're trying to get with keyline pattern cultivation, from my perspective, is that you're trying to have waterfall from a ridge, from a valley shape to a ridge shape. That's the basic parameter. Now, what we tried to moderate is the degree to which that fall occurs, which is where this whole thread of questioning started. If we follow the classic keyline pattern, and if I go back to the book for a moment, you'll see that. if I go back to these keyline patterns in the, if I follow these without question, if you look at this line here, that's quite a fall. So I'm going from the I'm going from the 110 to the 90. So that that might only be a 30, 50 yard distance, and I've fallen 10 yards, right? Now, that may well be completely unreasonable, and that's why I've just shown you what happens when the rubber hits the road.
Okay. Do you have like rules of thumb that you kind of follow, or to determine?
Well, like I said, I'll try and it's I'll try and keep it below about 15 or 10 degrees if I can.
Okay.
But often it'll work that way anyway.
Thanks.
The reason why we've got these diagrams is just to illustrate the concept, and then what we do through the process of this book is actually show how it happens in reality. Because these landscapes, this particular contour map is one out of Yeoman's books, and it's just a diagram, it's not an actual landscape. So, now, if we come to, which is why, you know, again, this is actually for the book, this particular diagram that I've got on the screen now, and that's the reason why I've done that, is because this is a real landscape with real contours, and it's a real situation. And this is the real way in which I would design it based on the context of this particular client. And as a result, it would be very unusual for us to come out with a design that actually looks like this. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And the further we go along with all of this, I mean, one of the reasons why I think a lot of people, including so-called experts that many of us have heard about, don't use Keyline is because they don't get it. Because they haven't gone through all of this stuff and played with all of these iterations in geometry to actually get it. And it does take a bit of time. And you've got to be reasonably dedicated to that. But once you do get it, then it becomes quite simple. And we know that because there's a number of people that we work with now who are doing exactly as I've done. And are doing it very, very well, in fact, in many cases, better than I do. So, which is great. So that just proves the point. But you're right, I mean, there are some guidelines, and you want to make it so that it's as low risk as possible, and that it's definitely not cavalier. It's a good word, thank you.
Darren, one more question about erosion. Would you apply that same 5% slope rule of thumb to a diversion drain when you're connecting key point dams in a series? Or is there a number that you would make you shy away from?
Yeah, great question. I would not go any harder fall than 1 in 100. Now, 1 in 100 is the fall that you have with a... That's a 1% fall, right? I'm going to have to go to my tables in the back here. Just bear with me for a moment. What do we say? 1 in 100. Probably another set. Degrees. Who's in that one? A 1 in 100 is a 0.57 degree fall, right?
Okay.
Quite a gentle fall. So most of the diversion drains that we will... Well, a 1 in 100 is the fall that you have on a sewer. Interestingly, when you research it, the reason why that come to that is if you go any slower, then the poo moves too quickly and it bangs up behind the toilet paper. And if you go too slowly, then it all clogs up. So 1 in 100 is what's been established as being a good flow rate for people's poo and the paper they wipe their bum with. Now, we will generally, I would only do that if I had a really stable soil type and I had a good stable topsoil over the gutter, right? In most cases, I will make diversion drains 1 in 300 to 1 in 400. So that means one metre or 1 yard or 1 foot of fall in 300 feet, 300 yards, 300 metres.
Thanks.
And that's it. Yeah. In some cases, I won't go generally any gentler than about 1 in 500. To go much gentler than that, if you've got a very high rainfall site, where you frequent, like in the tropics, where you're frequently getting really heavy levels of, 4 inches in an hour or 5 inches in an hour sort of stuff, then you want to go, 1 in 500, 1 in 600, because if you go much faster than that, then the water's flowing too quickly and you can get erosion. All right, well, I'll just close up on this Keyline thread. I think we're a bit over time, but that's okay. I don't think we're that far off being done. So the other, this is in this Keyline thing, in terms of planting systems, just to give you an indication of the comparisons between different systems and also the way that they're sort of developed. So here we have two key points. Got, let's change that colour again. We've got a key point here and a key point here in these primary valleys. We've paralleled off that down until the key lines have met with the lowest ridge contour. You can see that in this diagram. Here's the lowest ridge contour here, and here's the two key lines. What we've then done is I've paralleled off that common guideline, both above and beyond, and that's given me that shape. That familiar sort of shape that we've got there. Okay. And then what I've done is I've trimmed around the edge, and what I've also done is I've counted the length of all of these rows. Now with that, I've found that, then I've done a grid layout, an equidistant grid, and then I've done a contour layout, all of the same thing, all right? Now the contour layout, what you'll notice is that some areas, like in here, there isn't any tree, well, there aren't any tree rows. And the reason for that is because I've made it so that there's a 10 meter, or let's say 10 yard spacing between all trees. And so if I go up into, if I was to continue, say, this row any further up into here, it wouldn't be 10 metres apart. What I've done is I've put a 15 metre end row on the whole thing. So there's a 15 metre headland. So there has to be a turning room. Now, if I was to continue these contours any further, well, one, they wouldn't be 10 metres apart from the next tree, but two, I wouldn't be able to have a 15 metre headland because I'd crash into the next row. Right? So this is how we're sort of comparing apples with apples, because you've got to create the framework for comparison between different methods of layout. Now, What you'll also see is with many of these contours is, if I look at, say, this contour here, is that I follow it. Now, it's not a contour. What I should say is that what most people do, and this happens all over the US with soil conservation, terraces that have been built for the last 70 years, now with people doing permaculture swales, etc., the swales are generally not built 1 foot apart. You know, they're usually built 30 or 50 yards apart or so on agricultural landscapes. And so what then happens is that those swales are then, even if you're just mowing the grass, the swales are run parallel with them. And so whilst the swales themselves are on contour, the areas are not in between, are not. And so if I was to put a swale on this line, for example, and I put a swale on this line, for example, right, well, they're on contour, that's all cool. But what about if I parallel with those, what if I parallel with that contour, with the upper one, and then I run this line? Well, which way is the water now flowing? Well, that point there is higher than that point there, clearly. And so this is what happens with millions of hectares or acres of land across the US and elsewhere, other places where people have used contours as the guiding pattern, is that you still effectively drain your ridges, not from the contours, not from the contour swales or check banks or ditches or terraces, it's from the areas in between that you've run parallel with. And so you're still draining a landscape. And so that's the big difference between that pattern and the keyline pattern. So there's the three methods. Now, with this method here, the grid method, which is one of the most common methods in the world, and it can either go this way or it can go this way with the rows, downslope or across slope. Well, obviously, if it goes this way, it's draining the landscape. If it goes this way, well, this point here is higher than this point here, so it too is draining the landscape. So if that's not a concern to you, well then, do it. This method on this particular map is what I would call 100%, in that when you calculate the total row length, it has the highest, well, it has the greatest row length. I think it was 11.5 kilometres of rows. The contour method had, I think, 9.3 kilometres of rows, and so it was a 83%. It had 83% of the row length of the grid pattern. Okay. The keyline method had 96% of the row length of the grid pattern. And also had the pattern where water is falling to the ridge on every one of these rows. And also, like a grid pattern, has an equidistance between the rows, and like a grid pattern, the only turning area that you have is on the row ends. And so with that, as we've shown in, you know, even on the real landscape, we've got a significant improvement over the often used contour pattern that's used in all of this. So that's why, they're big reasons why we use it. And as you'll see in the book, we created a whole comparison, a rating comparison between different methods. This is Andrew, my illustrator, has done this. I've got to redo it before the book's released because he's put the wrong scores on things, but it sort of gives you an indication that some methods have better attributes than others. That's an important thing to realise and to question. Okay. Any questions?
The chart doesn't talk about equal solar exposure, even solar exposure. That the greater.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's an omission. I could add that too there. I don't think I've got the space in it right now. But
you got a lot.
that's primarily one of the reasons why we would look at, why a lot of people use a grid layout. Obviously a keyline and a contour layout are going to have a pretty similar outcome there because they both follow a similar shape. Well, they're both defined by contours, so they'll have a different similar shape, but definitely a grid pattern would often have a better solar outcome, definitely. I could take you to another section in the book there, because I have considered this. Where is it? Because it is an important point. I have it. Just bear with me. I know I've got it. Just bear with me. So when we look at... This is in the site analysis section, where we are looking at if we are going to install trees in an agricultural landscape, and we want to do it from an agroforestry perspective, which is where typically we'll be growing crops in the row in between the trees, which a lot of people will do, then understanding the sun angles and how much shade is cast is obviously very important in design. So it's certainly something I consider. And so if I go to a design and I look at that, I've got, for example, a east-west facing contour, and that's what I'm going to be guided by, that's when this really comes into question. If I've got a north-south facing contour, then it's not really a big deal. Unless, of course, I want to grow something that has a really high light need, and then I'll definitely look at the height of the trees that I'm growing and whether they're evergreen or deciduous. So there will be those parameters in design, definitely.